We are celebrating Black History Month with Dr. Cleve Francis. You may know him as a cardiologist at Inova Mount Vernon Hospital, but he is also a world-renowned musician who is included in the musical section of the National Museum of African American History and Culture in Washington, D.C. Dr. Francis was nice enough to record an interview with me and share with me photos and videos from his journey to becoming the first African American cardiologist in the Inova Health System and his success in the music industry. We talked for over an hour, but I edited it down into something that I'm proud to present in honor of Black History Month.
I was born in Jennings, Louisiana, April 22nd, 1945. I was born in complete segregation. I went to an all-Black high school. It was in Jefferson Davis Parish, and I didn't even know who Jefferson Davis was, but that turns out to be the president of the Confederacy, and I went to the school named after this guy, Jefferson Davis High. I remember once what happened to me in a place called Opelousas, Louisiana. I was on my way to a science fair. I had won first place in a science fair, and my high school teacher smoked and he needed some matches. So we stopped and I just walked in this little bar and asked for a penny box of matches. But the town of Opelousas on the right-hand side, it was white, and the left-hand side was Black down the main street. And I wasn't familiar with that town. And out of nowhere, I still can remember a fist about as big as a basketball. I really was knocked out. And my high school teacher and my friends in the car came and got me and put me in the car. We couldn't call the police because we'd have been arrested for trespassing. And the sign did say white only. But anyway, the interesting thing, when I got back home, you know, my mouth's all bloody, blood all, and my mother, you know, took care of me. And she came in the room later and she said to me, she said, if this guy ever fell in a well, would you save him? And I looked up and why was she asking me that? I mean, she said, would you save him? And I thought about it. I said, I probably would. She said, well, good. And that's all she did. She walked out and she was saying, do not let an incident like that turn you into an angry man. You're not gonna go anywhere.
Powerful lesson. And you did go somewhere.
I ended up getting to college. I went to Southern University in Baton Rouge, majored in biology. And the first week I was there, I was on campus. I had to go to the infirmary. I had some cold or something, and I saw a Black physician for the first time in my life. And he was a guy, had to be in his late 80s. He was just doing the student health. And the next week, I changed my major to pre-medical biology. I said, that's what I want to do. But interesting thing happened when I finished college. I applied to about 12 medical schools around the country. I was just getting the applications and applying. And then I got turned down by all of these places. I was so devastated. 12 schools, 12 rejections. I didn't realize that, you know, that you get an application from an all-Black school that, you know, maybe is thrown in the trash can. But even now when people apply to medical school, they look where you come from. And that's part of the institutional racism. If you don't come from a typical school that they know of, then you reject it.
So the medical schools weren't going to take a Southern University grad. What did you do next?
I was lucky. I did get accepted to the College of William and Mary in Williamsburg for graduate schools. I was a graduate assistant in biology. And Southern University, there were 10,000 Black students there. When I arrived in Williamsburg, which was the first time I ever left the state, I was one of five Blacks on the whole campus at William and Mary. Wow, like what do we do here? But it turns out I was well equipped for that. I wasn't emotionally destroyed. The town, the Black people in the town took me in. And I was like, told them I was coming to William & Mary. They were like, hey, you're a hero here.
Now, we haven't talked about music yet. I know you were into writing and performing from a young age, but now in Williamsburg, you had even more opportunities to explore your musical side.
The folk culture was there, you know, like Peter, Paul, Mary, and Beatles and everything. So I started playing in coffee houses and little places around town, little bars, and got to be pretty well known, but my eye was still on the prize of, you know, getting to medical school. I found out that it was a lot different applying from William & Mary to medical school than it was from Southern University. So I applied to the Medical College of Virginia, which was in Richmond, which is probably 50 miles down the road, and got accepted. And I was one of two African Americans accepted in the freshman class in 1969. My roommate also didn't realize I was black, so went up to my dorm room. He was already in there, and his whole family was in there. Their mouths fell on the floor almost, and they was like, oh my God, this guy's black. I wanted to give these guys a break, so I said, let me go down to my car and get the rest of my things. And when I came back, they had all gone down the back stairs and took every stitch of clothes and anything he had in the room out. So people have asked me about this over the years, said, well, did you feel bad? I was like, about what? I mean, I had two beds, I had two lamps, I had two closets.
Always making lemonade out of lemons. Let me summarize and move it forward a little. So you were with 10,000 African-American students at Southern University. Then you were one of five African-Americans at William & Mary. Then at Medical College of Virginia, it was just you and one other African-American in your class. So where did you go next?
So when I graduated from MCV in 1973, I got accepted to the George Washington University Hospital in Washington, D.C. to do my internship and medical residency. I was the only black in my class, and I decided to go into cardiology, and I was probably the only black and the first black cardiology fellow at George Washington University. Well, when I decided to go into cardiology, the chief of cardiology was not supportive of that, and it wasn't academic, and I assume it was probably racial. He said there were three people ahead of me, but it turns out that when it all ended up, the other three people went somewhere else, so I kind of got this position by default. But when he called me to tell me about I had gotten a position, he just said, you've got the position, and hung up the phone. So that's how I entered my cardiology fellowship. I did a really good job in my fellowship, and then when it came time to look for jobs, they were not going to hire me. And it was really, they weren't hiring black cardiologists. The doctors were afraid what would happen in their communities and blah, blah, blah. All of a sudden, I'm pariah, you know. And actually, for the first time, I did break down. I did cry on the steps of GW Hospital for a moment there. I said, you know, all this travel, this trip from Jennings to Williamsburg to Richmond to here, and I've done what these guys have asked me to do, and then all of a sudden it's raced.
So you changed your way of thinking, and you decided to just go ahead and start up your own cardiology practice.
I mean, I was following this model. You go and you work and you beg somebody, you interview. It's like, how do you set up a practice? You go to a bank, you get a line of credit like all the other, you buy your treadmill, you buy a typewriter, you hire a secretary. And so I wrote up a handwritten proposal and went to the bank and asked them for a line of credit for $30,000. My hand was shaking, but $30,000 is a lot of money. And the woman said this was a great proposal, and they granted it.
Tell me about how you hired your first office manager. I love this story.
Everybody I had interviewed, I interviewed nurses, I interviewed other secretaries, and I would ask them, who's the most important person in the office? And they would say, well, the doctor is. And one would say, well, the doctor, then the nurse. And this lady, without hesitation, she said, the patient. I said, ma'am, you are hired. And so I hired her because that's the philosophy that I wanted to live behind. And then I decided that the practice should be not all black, not all white, and it should be an international, interracial, multicultural practice. That group was just incredible. You walk in the office and hear all these different languages, all these different holidays we celebrated it. They used to call us the Silk Road Cardiology, but it was known as Mount Vernon Cardiology Associates, and it grew to become the second largest all cardiology practice in Northern Virginia. Our mission was treating people with heart disease. Didn't matter what color they were wrapped in or where they went to school or where they went to church. And that worked for me.
By the way, I'm told you have a reputation for being the best dressed doctor around. Why is that?
Well, that didn't happen by chance. My first trip into the hospital, when I first got my first consult, I was called by a referring doctor who said, this patient is crashing. So I grabbed my shirt and trousers and stethoscope and came in through the doctor's entrance and went into radiology to look at the x-ray. Well, a security guard saw me enter the hospital and couldn't find me. And he called the Fairfax County police. And so when I came out of radiology, there was a couple of police officers and security guards at the elevators. And they were saying, well, I saw him. I said, oh, okay, let me go up here and fix this. So I walked up to the crowd and said, I'm Dr. Cleveland Francis. I'm the new cardiologist here. And I just pushed the elevator and went up to the critical care unit. But from that point on, I always was fully dressed. I had a three-piece suit on or tie and shine shoes when I came to the ER. And some people even today said, we couldn't figure out why you were so dressed up at 2 and 3 in the morning, but that's where that came from.
I imagine building the practice from scratch was a lot of work.
It was 24/7. And, Sundays blended into Mondays. I didn't realize I was probably burning out. I mean, you can't keep that kind of schedule. But I waited until I could add the right partners. And so I waited 2 years for my first partner. And then we started adding a doctor every couple of years to our practice and to share the call. But I did it for 2 years, 24/7.
So you've come a long way from Jennings, but now your journey takes a different turn. You explore a new opportunity in the music industry?
It happened by chance. I wasn't trying to get a music contract from anybody. I wasn't knocking on anybody's doors, but I was always involved in the music. And in the course of my work, I went to the emergency room to take care of a patient who had a heart attack. And his brother happened to be in the music business. And when he came from Florida to visit him, we got to talking and I had this music stuff I was doing. So he said, bring me a tape of some of the stuff you've done. So I did bring a tape and gave it to the brother. He went back to Florida and gave it to a record producer. Then I get a call in my office. Somebody said, I really like this tape. We should do something. We ended up going to Nashville recording an album called Last Call for Love. And I recorded a song called Love Light, which was the B-side of the Glen Campbell's Rhinestone Cowboy. And we made a video, and that thing got on country music television, and all of a sudden in a rotation with Garth Brooks and Vince Gill and Reba McEntire. And the president of Capitol Records saw this, and so they called me in my office and sent a ticket for me to go to Nashville, and he signed me up to a record deal at his kitchen table. So this opportunity is never going to happen again. So I decided to do it and took off and went and traveled around the United States for 3 years and went overseas to Canada, did concerts in England and Scotland and Virgin Islands and made music videos and recordings and played the Grand Ole Opry. And after 3 years, you know, I'd gone as far as I could go. They do have some institutional racism issues there as well. And only one black man had made it in country music, and that was Charlie Pratt. And I performed with him, I met him, and I decided at this point, rather than ride this out, I would go back to my original occupation. There was still a lot of patients needed care, so I came back and resumed my medical practice. But I maintained my performances at the Birchmere locally, and that's a national place with artists all over the country. And I've probably been playing there for over 20 years. So I have a packed crowd once a year at the Birchmere. Also did a couple of projects for the Vietnam Memorial. I wrote a song called Reflections on the Wall and was invited to sing it at the Vietnam Memorial. And I also worked at Mount Vernon Hospital in a ceremony called the Lights of Love Ceremony. Did that for about 25 years to raise money for the auxiliary. So
let me also mention, I love the song Martin that you wrote in honor of the legacy of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. and I know you got to perform that at Freedom Plaza with a full choir and Mrs. Coretta Scott King in attendance. I encourage everybody to check that out on YouTube after watching this interview.
It's all one story, you know, you're helping mankind, and I do it with EKGs and medicines, but you can also do it with music. I felt that I was born for this kind of thing.
You found so many ways to use your experiences and talents to enrich others. Among other things, you're the co-chairman of the Inova Heart and Vascular Institute Antiracism and Equality Task Force. Why is that important to you?
You have to become involved in the organization. I've been with Inova so long that, you know, I am Inova. And so when people talk about the Inova Health System, they're talking about me because I helped create that reputation. And as a consequence, I'm in a position to help recruit other African Americans or make sure that, you know, working on this anti-racism task force only because I've been part of it. And the same little hospital where they called the cops because I was in radiology, I became the president of the medical staff there. And I went on to become the medical affairs president, representing all of the physicians of Inova at the board level for about 2 years. So all of my doctors, you'll see them getting on committees, you'll see them running for chairman of this and that. In the end, if you do a good job, you do pave the way for some people and who have no idea you came through this particular area, but you do carry that on your shoulder.
In 2018, you were recognized by the medical profession and received the Pioneer Award for your lifetime contribution to the field of cardiology by the Heart and Vascular Institute of the Inova Health System. Your thoughts?
You know, when you see somebody who's achieved a lot of things, you don't achieve these things by yourself. You have to have help. You know, my mother, my wife, you know, and mentors along the way, other physicians. Dr. Perkins encouraged me to do music. My friend Victor, managing my first recording. The doctor at MCV giving me a perspective of what it meant to stay the course. I couldn't have got from Jennings, Louisiana to where I am now unless people knew I was quite serious about this journey. And so people were happy to pitch in to help me, you know, including taking me in and feeding me and a place to sleep. And I just showed up and said, I'm on this journey. And I hope we never lose that in this country, that if people start out without money, without all the typical things you would think they should have, unfortunate, they still should be able to make it. And we should extend the hand and we should mentor them.
Thank you, Dr. Francis. You by my side, you do my heart good. You make love feel like it should. Anyone can see by the way I look.